All right, welcome back to Rock Hard with Jay Conroy on RockHardRadio1.com from New York City. As promised, we have the local rock band Lost Romance in the studio with us tonight. We have Amin Smyers on drums, and he's also got a very special, what do you call that, Amin?
Well, we call this a small tarija, which is a specific Moroccan drum.
It's very cool. And he does have a full drum kit because I've seen these guys play. All right, on guitar and lead vocals, Jerry Perlinski.
Got it.
And our bass player, Alexander Paul. Did I pronounce that right, Alexander?
Absolutely. Thanks for having us.
Well, thank you guys for coming in very, very much.
Thank you. Thanks.
I want to start off by talking about the way we hooked up, because I think it's only right. Is you guys were playing at the Make-A-Wish or If I Only Had a Brain Foundation,
right?
For the Warner family, and I know you know the Warner family very well,
yeah.
As do I. So mm-hmm. I wanted to start off the interview, talking about what a great family that they are.
Sure.
I mean, I have known them for years. They have always, from Gail to Big Jeff to Jason to Jeffrey to Amanda, a great family. They've always been nothing but nice to me, and that's why it's like anything they want, anything they need, I'm there for them. So that's actually how we hooked up, because I was kind of DJing in between bands and you guys were playing. Mm-hmm. And Jeffrey had said to me, look, you really got to talk to this guy, Jerry. He's really good and the band is really good and all that sort of thing. And, we got chit chatting and I said, hey, let's get you on the show. So let me start off by asking, where did you come up? First of all, when did the band form?
Okay, it formed pretty much around, I'm trying to think, it was about like end of 2011, 2012, somewhere around there. And originally it was a solo project for myself.
Mm-hmm.
And I went into the studio to record a couple tracks, and it was going to be under my name just as a solo album. But by the time we got done with it, I kind of felt like it had more of a band vibe to it.
Mm-hmm.
I had session guys play on the record, so it was like just kind of like a solo thing, but I decided to form a band after that. So that's kind of how it started. Just started looking for people in the scene, in the local scene to play with, and people that were digging the kind of songs that I was writing, and we just kind of started from there.
Okay, so that being said, how did you find Amin and Alexander? How did that come about?
The internet.
always.
I sort of, not completely. I actually met Amin on Craigslist. We just,
What's so funny? Yeah. I had a band. We were talking before we went on mm-hmm. the air, and I had a band in here last week called Damn Glad, mm-hmm. and two of their members they found through Craigslist.
Yeah.
So you were found through Craigslist.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And yeah. How about you, Alexander?
Me and Jerry are actually in the same art collective,
yeah.
Tiny Giant Art Collective.
Mm-hmm.
And my band...
Wait, what is that art?
It's it started as a North Jersey thing, but it's all over the country. Tiny Giant has tons of bands in it, and they're kind of all working towards the same goal.
Uh-huh.
And it's really neat that in doing that and just being your own band, you kind of get to link up with other guys like Jerry who are also pushing for the same goal. So when I saw he posted on the local Tiny Giant page, which is, again, all these people connected just through music, I filled in for bass and he asked me to fill in from there, and it's been history since.
So about 2011 is when the three of you got together, or did you start in 2011?
I kind of started 2011, and I played with a couple different incarnations of the band with different people, and just kind of was trying to find the right lineup and the right, trying to get our footing and everything, and because, the music scene's pretty, it's big, but it's small,
Yeah.
I mean, it's, and people that are good, that want to play in an original band as opposed to playing in a cover band, if you're really good, you're playing in about three other bands.
Right.
So it ends up being that, sometimes people have too many bands that they're in and something has to drop, So, which is understandable, so it kind of went through a couple different incarnations since then. And I've been playing with Amin for at least the past, almost a year. Yeah, just about a year or so. And we had our friend Tony who was playing bass with us, for just about that time. And he's in about three other bands. So it was just around that time we ended up doing a show in Asbury Park, and he couldn't do the show, so I kind of posted to the Tiny Giant Artist Collective, which is like a Facebook group, it's like a private Facebook group, and I was like, hey, anybody want to learn all our tunes in a week? Jump on stage with us, and anybody's up for the challenge, and Alex accepted, so...
Good you know, for you, yeah. man. Yeah, yeah. Way so. To step up to that.
Yep, of course.
Yeah, I was looking at your website. Mm-hmm. Was that possibly a gig you did at the Wonder Bar down there?
We did a show at the Wonder Bar, but no, that was a show at Asbury Lanes.
Oh, okay.
Asbury Lanes, yeah. Right. It was actually a Tiny Giant Summer Bummer, it was called.
All right. So
it was actually a three-day festival. It was Friday at the Court Tavern in New Brunswick, mm-hmm. New Jersey.
That's the one that Science played.
Right. Yes. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Alex actually has another band called Science, which he's the lead singer and guitar player. And so,
which, by the way, mm-hmm. speaking of the Court Tavern, mm-hmm. and you know, as my listeners know, Rock Hard is based here in New York City. The Court Tavern is in New Brunswick, New Jersey. And New Brunswick, New Jersey, first of all, it's a college town because Rutgers is there, but they have a very, very happening club scene and band scene. And the Court Tavern is like locally famous. Mm-hmm, yeah. And I know that you guys have a gig there where you're going to be debuting the new album, right?
Yep,
it's like a
absolutely.
Record release party?
Absolutely. Album release party. It's going to be September 14th, Saturday night. We're playing with a ton of great bands. A band called The Everymen, who are from Jersey City / Brooklyn / down the shore somewhere. They're like 10-piece band now, I think, at this point. They're absolutely awesome. Good friends of ours. Also, Chris Batten and The Woods, who's they're a local band from that area, from New Brunswick. And also a band from Hoboken called Hello Radio, which are also good friends of ours. So it's going to be a really great night.
It sounds that way. In fact, yeah. I am definitely going to try to make that. Definitely going to try to make that. Where'd you come up with the name for the band? How'd that come about?
Yeah, the name, it's funny. The name, I mean, you know, people may think like, oh, you know, Lost Romance, they may take it for like face value of what it is. But I was actually, you know, reading something that a friend of mine posted up on Facebook. He's a producer here in the city. He has his own studio, recording studio. He mixed our album. This guy named David Patillo. He's in a band called the Dead X's. They're a really great like blues punk band from New York City. And he was kind of like, you know, kind of talking about how, you know, a little bit about the gentrification of the Lower East Side and how it's kind of,
whoa, back up, Jerry. That's a big word for me. What does that mean?
Basically,
wait, first of all, say the word again.
Gentrification.
Gentrification. Yeah. Sounds like a sexual act.
Well,
okay.
No. That's after hours. That's after hours.
All right. So, but what does that mean?
Well, really.
And my listeners are going to be going, sure. Boy, Jay is really a fucking idiot. He doesn't know what that means. But, you know, I tell it like it is. So
well,
what does that mean?
In simple terms, it means that, you know, when you have a poor area that maybe is kind of run down and, you know, there's maybe not a lot of businesses in the area. You know, first the arts community comes in. They try to like, you know, they have all like really great art spaces and everything's cheap. You
true,
know, you go
right.
there, you know, you get studios, you get all these other things. And that's when creativity really, you know, flourishes, when there's no rules. So there's mm-hmm. no boundaries. There's nothing, you know. And, you know, in like probably like the 70s, late 70s, early 80s, that's, you know, in the punk new wave scene. And, you know, punk started in the Lower East Side and, you know, CBGBs and all that sort of thing.
Sure, yeah.
You know, it really was still, you know, Alphabet City was still a dangerous place
right.
at that time.
Right.
You know, so...
All the
know,
junkies and heroin
right,
dealers
right.
and yeah.
Exactly. So, and my, you know, my buddy still lives on the Lower East Side. He's been living there since, I think, the 90s or so. And, you know, it just sort of was talking about how, you know... Not necessarily, you know, the bad thing, you know, it's not a bad thing to get rid of the drugs and all the other, you know, bad things that go along with it, but all the mom and pop stores, all the, you know, artisans in that neighborhood are kind of disappearing and getting replaced by a Citibank or a Starbucks
mm-hmm.
or, you know, all these corporate, you know, places. And kind of the soul that of that part of the city is starting to get lost. And he was talking about, you know, getting your shoes shined, you know, on a street corner.
Yeah.
And the lost romance of that. You know, losing that lost art or the
and
lost
that's kind of where it came
yeah,
from.
Yeah, that's where it came from.
That's
yeah.
perfect.
Yeah, so
that's
it's sort
perfect.
Of like, you know, the lost art of music or creativity or whatever
yeah.
those things are that, you know, makes the world what it is, you know? And
right.
it's and that sort of, we're trying to like still kind of hold on to that old art form of rock and roll, you know, which is, you know, not what it used to be anymore, right. You know, because everybody's got their you know, flavor of the week. And
That's the biggest problem is the flavor of the week.
Yeah.
You know, first off, you know, I live here in the city, and I, you know, I'm not going to give away my address. I have fucking stalkers. That's the last thing I need is for them to know where I live. But, you know, same thing. I live uptown, and that's exactly what's starting to happen is musicians are moving in, you know, college kids are moving in, you know, artists are moving in, and it's cool. But it's funny because up in my neighborhood, a Starbucks wouldn't last 2 months.
Mm-hmm.
There's no fucking banks up there because people don't use banks.
Right,
they use, you know, check cashing places. You know, I think half of these people are illegal, you know, in the country, whatever. Sure. But, you know, I mean, it's a great neighborhood, but I see the same, you know, the same thing that, you know, that you're talking about. So I totally get that. So now what were some of your influences?
As far as the band or just me?
Well, musically, like in the first place, yeah. Like, what got you started? You know, what were the first kinds of bands you got into? And
well, you know, I mean, I was gonna say everybody, but a lot of time, you know, when you're learning to play guitar, you learn, you know, from the masters, all the classic rock masters, you know, like, you know, Led Zeppelin and, you know, Van Halen and all those cats, you know. And but I was big into the Police, you know.
Okay.
Growing up, you know, they're a big influence on me, I would say. But then, you know, a lot of indie rock kind of stuff that started probably like in the 90s and, you know, late 80s and that sort of thing. A lot of alternative underground kind of bands, like, you know, at the time they weren't really that big, but like the Replacements and Husker Du.
What a great band.
Well, yeah.
Both of them great bands. Right. Yeah.
Yeah. So that was kind of at least my you know, reason for keeping going with this band as sort of like a power pop kind of band with that kind of punk undertone, you know. Because they really did it right, you know. I mean, they kind of started alternative, Bob Mould and you know, Husker Du and all those guys, and just, you know, I kind of wanted, you know, band's a little bit of a nod to those guys, but still, you know, kicking in the modern flavor at the same time. So
right. Well, you know, like I said, I saw you play, and you know, I was impressed. I'm like, you know, these guys are tight. They're well rehearsed. You could see it. You know, good stage presence on all of you.
Thank you.
You know,
thanks.
And you know, I liked it a lot. The thing I liked when we first talked, and we're going to try to play a little bit of this, is what I thought was interesting. Well, there's a couple of things. What I thought was interesting is that you recorded a live album before you recorded a studio album, which I thought was smart because, you know, I'm guessing that, you know, it's hard to book studio time. It's expensive to book studio time.
Right.
You guys were playing up in Boston, and you were like, you know, what the fuck? Let's record this.
Well, in all honesty, I had the studio album recorded first.
Did you?
We did have it recorded first, but we didn't release it yet.
Okay.
And it was like, you know, time was moving, and we didn't release it yet, and I was just holding out for it because we were working with a record label, and we were dealing with them in order for them to release it. And I'm just like, you know what? We need to release something. So let's just release this, like, at least as a teaser, just to get something out there.
Yeah.
You know, that's kind of how it happened. So you're sort of right in a way, you know. But at the same time, it kind of happened that someone was there recording that night. And I was like, well, why not? Why not release it? You know, I mean, people put out videos on YouTube or whatever. It was just really something raw and fun and just... And that was it, you know. I said, "Look, let's something to remember the night with." So.
Yeah, and I thought it was a great idea, you know, if nothing else, in the sense of it's like you get to hear the band live,
right?
You know, and I mean, if you go back in certain rock history, I mean, look at, you know, Frampton Comes, as we always like to call it, you know, Frampton Comes Alive, you know, Kiss Alive, Lynyrd Skynyrd One More for the Road, those three live albums, so from those three bands. Really broke those bands wide open.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, Peter Frampton, I mean, he was in Humble Pie back in the day. He had all these solo albums that went nowhere, and then he records a live album in San Francisco, and it goes through the roof. And, you know, Skynyrd, same thing. I mean, they were doing okay, but as soon as they put out that live album, it was like, look out.
Right.
You know? So I really like that idea.
Well, thanks.
Also, the thing I like is that you guys are working. You were telling me that you play about five times a month. Is that correct?
Average at this point, yeah.
Yeah. In fact, I saw you played at the World Cafe.
Yeah, we're going to be playing. They're going to be playing there, 21st.
That is a beautiful hall, is it not?
Great. It's a great room. It really is. Yeah.
Oh, I did a gig there last summer, and I was like, "This is a badass place." You know?
Yeah.
This is really cool. Yeah. But you go from like where like. You don't just like play in New Jersey. Tell me where you play. You play up in Boston.
Yep. We play up in Connecticut, Boston. Played up in Portland, Maine. Yep. And then down in Philly, and probably gonna be doing some more shows down like in D.C. and Baltimore and Delaware, and probably hitting Virginia.
There's a great club in D.C. called. It's very similar to World Cafe.
Mm-hmm.
And why can't I think of it right now? Well, I can't, but anyway, that would be like a perfect place for you guys to play too, because it's kind of the same setup as World Cafe.
Okay.
You know, now it's going to bother me, and I sound stupid on my own show because I can't remember the name of the place.
Was it Black Cat? No.
No. It was definitely like a hall, like World Cafe was.
Okay,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah. And the interesting part is kind of back to what we were saying. It's in a slum of a neighborhood.
Right.
And this place had been there like forever and ever and ever, and it was empty. And then they put something like $8 million into this place to redo it. But you walk outside, and I mean, you're in the ghetto, and I was working down there with a band, and my girlfriend was coming to see me because she's down there, and I. You know, originally I was like, yeah, just drive there. And then I got a whiff of the neighborhood. I said, honey, valet. Okay? I'm like, trust me when I tell you, valet.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And, you know, yeah, it was like a really rough neighborhood. I mean, I walked around during the day and stuff, went to stores and stuff like that. Nobody bothered me. But you could see it's like, this may not be the kind of place you want to be at 3 a.m.
Right.
You know, by yourself.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So, now how do you land up booking those gigs? Because that's not easy to do.
Yeah, I mean, it depends. A lot of times we do it ourselves, you know. I mean, I connect with other bands in other cities. You know, that's really the way to do it. You know, it's called gig trading, you know. So, we'll find a band in, let's say, Boston who has a similar vibe to us, a similar sound, and they've got a good following up there. So, we'll say, hey, you know, if you guys hook us up with a show up there, we'll hook you up with a show down here. You know, in Jersey or New York.
That's a great idea.
Yeah. That's really kind of how the underground, pretty much the indie rock scene kind of works, you know, as far as touring is concerned. You know, because everybody knows that, you know, if you're not known in that area, it's going to be tough for you to draw people.
Right.
But if you're opening up for a local band down there who has a draw already, you know, that's going to help, you know, at the end of the night.
That's extremely smart marketing on your part.
Yeah.
And I do not, you're probably the first local band I've had in here that does that.
Really?
Yeah.
I know a million bands that do it.
Well, you know, first of all, this is New York City, so it's tough.
Right,
you know? And, you know, I mean, I've gotten to see some like really great bands that I know, and it's like without their friends, there's nobody there.
Right.
You know,
right,
and you're like, man, this sucks. You know, it's not like it used to be in the music business. It's a lot harder. I mean, I have to tell you guys, you know? So I think that's a brilliant idea. So I'm going to get to one of your songs right now.
Sure.
This is off your new CD that comes out. When's it come out? September?
It's going to be September 14th is the CD release party. Yep.
Okay. So it actually comes out the day you're playing Court Tavern?
It should come. It may come out a little bit before then. Like I said, we're still in, still working out the details of that with the label right now. So.
All right. What label are you with?
Well, we're talking with a label called Starving Dog Records in LA.
Okay.
So kind of just going over the contract right now, and hopefully we'll have that settled by end of the week. So.
All right. I'm going to play a song that I really like. I don't know if this is the opening track, but it's the first track that I saw. It's called Looking for That Silver Bullet.
Yeah, that's the first song. Yeah.
All right, let's do it.
Losing your
That is a badass song. Looking for that silver bullet. You know, I hear so many influences in your voice, and the first one that comes to mind is Robert Smith from The Cure, believe it or not.
Really?
Yeah, believe it or not.
Okay.
You know,
I'll take
but
that.
It's yeah, of course.
First time I've heard that actually.
Yeah, well, I'm listening to it. I'm like, there's so many influences in here, but I can't think of them. But I'm like, Robert Smith is kind of like, you know, the first one that I hear in there. So, that's a great song, straight ahead rocker. I like that a lot. Now who does the writing? Do you do all the writing, Jerry, or does everybody pitch in?
Well, for this recording, for the most part, yeah, I mean, I wrote most of the tunes. But we actually just, you know, a couple weeks ago or last time we had a rehearsal, we kind of started writing some stuff together. So a little collaboration. So, we're going to see where it goes, you know?
Yeah. Now, Jerry, where are you from?
Jersey, man.
But are you,
Central Jersey.
Are you like local Greenbrook, Dunellen guy?
Middlesex, actually.
Okay.
I grew up in Middlesex.
All right.
Yeah, that's where I grew up. So.
Yeah, I'm a North Playfield guy,
yeah.
So yeah.
Down the road.
Right down the road.
Yep.
All right, interesting.
Yeah.
So did you ever back in the day do the scenes of like, you know, Kerwin's and Zupco's?
Kerwin,
you must have.
Yep.
All those places.
They're still there.
They're still there.
Still
you ever
there,
still
man.
Play there once in a while?
I haven't played there, no. I mean, I've been to Zupco's. I don't know, it was the last time I was there. My friends played there. My friends from Denali. I have a band called Little Dipper, and I'm trying to think who else played there. It's, just, you know, most of the cover bands now and that kind
yeah.
of thing. But I haven't played there in a long time. So, yeah, that's always a treat.
Amin, where are you from?
I'm from Morocco.
Morocco, this must have came right from Morocco
yep,
with you. This
exactly.
your drum thing, huh? And how long have you been here in the U.S.?
3 years.
Really?
Yep.
Good for you, man. What made you come here?
Well, I came here.
Were you wanted in Morocco when you had a?
Nah, not at all.
Running from the law?
Yeah.
Not at all. I was there actually doing music with some bands, and we were very famous in there. Playing with the rock band and with the fusion band. Then after that I got my green card, then I moved here. And I was looking for bands on Craigslist and then I met you. Yeah,
so you came to this country to pursue a music career?
Kind of, yes.
Yeah.
Well, I came here to try to pursue a music career and also for work.
Right.
Yes.
Right. Which almost kind of doesn't go hand in hand, music career and work, but you know, so
gotta pay the bills somehow, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Alexander, where are you from?
I'm from North Jersey, Clifton area, Montclair, you know, right off of.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. It's local. Like I said, I'm born, bred Jersey, so you know, I totally get it. All right, Lost Romance is here with instruments.
Mm-hmm.
Actually. You got to keep helping me out on this thing. What do you call this thing again?
This is small tarija.
Do me a favor, play a little bit of this because I dig this thing.
It sounds like a djembe, but it's not a djembe. It's a tarija. It's used for Moroccan popular music.
Okay, go ahead. Rock out a little bit for me. Yeah. Fuck yeah. I like that. Let me tell you something. You can make a killing on the fucking subways here in New York.
All right. All right.
I like that. That sounds good. And Jerry has a guitar. Alexander has his bass. So these guys are going to do a tune for us. What do you guys want to do?
Hold on one second.
Yeah, Jerry's going over to get the camera ready. So.
What do you think about Dopamine?
Yeah, I think that's a good one to do. Should do that one.
Oh, yeah, I really like that.
I actually heard that on the live album and I was like,
okay.
This is a cool song. I like this. So hang on, they're just gonna get the camera set up and then they're gonna rock a little Dopamine for you. Where does that song come from? What can you tell me about that?
That song, hold on one second.
Jerry, you know we're fucking recording for Christ's sakes.
I would speak for Jerry, but I didn't write the song.
Yeah.
I would say it comes from the chemical in your brain.
Exactly. See, Alex knows what we're talking about.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm also a salesman, so you know,
uh-huh.
I can talk my way out of any jam.
Hold on.
Even when the lead guitarist and singer is over messing with his iPhone.
Right, right. He's lucky this is the kind of show that it is. Yeah. You know what I mean?
DJ, we're best friends. We could just chat all night.
Yeah. In fact, I'm done with these two.
Yeah, right? Let's talk about my man, Jay.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, no, that's the kind of show this is, man. It's like I try to make it loose and you know, comfortable and just, you know,
it is
bullshit and, you know, not be like this strict, you know, like interview show where, you know, it's uptight.
I listen to a lot of talk radio, sometimes about music, but I'll just in general, you know, Opie and Anthony and Ron Fez and stuff that
guys
over on XM. And yeah, it's like you listen to some people and they're very regimented on what they're
doing.
Yeah,
you know.
It's not fun. It's not a conversation.
No.
You
want to
be having a conversation that everyone else is listening to, I feel.
Yeah, I don't like being, you know, too regimented. I mean, you know, you have to have, you know, some sort of you know. Yeah, to the show, you know. In fact, my producer's always up my ass. He's like, always like, you know, well, I think, you know, we should start doing this and we should start doing that. And I'm like, you know, well, unfortunately, knows a lot.
So that's the worst. It's better when he knows nothing.
I know. But, you know, it's funny because when he first started producing the show and he built the website, his name is Chris Madden, and he's like phenomenal. Without him, I would be nowhere. And, you know, Chris, you know, would never really say anything about the show. And then all of a sudden he starts with, you know, I think the show should have an open, and I think the show should have this, and I think the show should have that. And I'm like, you know, dude, you're going to make me sound forced. And I don't want to sound forced, right?
Right, yeah.
But the funniest part, let me tell you a little side story, is you know, he texts me and he says, listen, man, he says, you know, the show needs more of an open, because he goes, I flushed the toilet and I missed your open, you know? He's like, it was too short. So me, I'm like thinking, all right, I got the answer for this, right? So I go upstairs. I'm like, listen, man. I said, when I go see Aerosmith, I said, Aerosmith comes out. They play three songs before they say a fucking word.
Yeah, right.
I said, that's what I do. I said, I get on here. I say, it's Rock Hard with Jay Conroy. I start rocking, and there it is. And he looks at me and he goes, dude, the difference is you can see Aerosmith, okay? He goes, you can't see you. And I went, you got me on that one, Chris. All right. So, all right. You guys ready?
Yeah, we're ready.
All right. We're going to do a little dopamine from Lost Romance. Hit it, guys.
On your love, on your love, on your love.
damn, that was great. That's a great, great song. I mean, I'm bopping here in the studio. And if I'm bopping here in the studio, what a great song, man. I mean, incredible. Dopamine. Love it.
Thank you.
Love it, love it, love it. So, yeah, I hope that turns up on an album. It's not going to be on your current album, right?
Not on the EP that's coming out in September, but it will be out, yeah.
Wow. Yeah, I totally hope that that works out. So
yeah, you can catch a live version of that on that live record that we did. It's on Bandcamp.
Yeah.
Yeah, lostromance.bandcamp.com. And you can check out all the other good stuff on lostromance.net.
And that was recorded in Boston, right?
Yeah, in a place called Great Scott in it's a small section in Boston called Alston.
Of course, yeah, I know. I've heard of Alston. Yeah,
yeah, Alston,
absolutely.
So, yeah, it's a great, great little arts community over there, and really support the music scene pretty well. So it's a fun place to play.
You know what? Let's play a track from that live album.
Sure.
You guys tell me. I want to hear the most rocking track on that. So what would that be?
Probably the last track on there, Turn Away.
Okay.
It's probably the heaviest one.
That's what I like. The show's called Rock Hard with
Jay
Conroy.
Right. Not Rock
like...
Soft, right?
No, Rock Soft, that's another show. That's when we do the Eagles and fucking Air Supply and
there
all that
go.
Shit. All right, here we go.
Oh, yeah! Go Sox!
All right, come on.
We're
not starting anymore. This is our last song, and again, we're Lost Romance. Can you check us out online, lostromance.net, and all that good stuff. This is so much we
Yeah, Turn Away, that's from the Boston gig, and sounds like you guys are really ripping up the crowd on that gig.
Yeah, we actually opened up for some friends of ours that were from Jersey, but also we had a connection through Boston, this songwriter Steffi Copeland and the Pedestrians, and we actually opened up for them, so it was a really great crowd that night, and so we just played just before they did, so it was a packed house. It was an awesome time.
Nice, and such a good feeling, right?
Yeah,
when it's a packed house and people are just like rocking, you know?
Mm-hmm. And it was kind of funny because we just finished that song and I walked off stage and she's like, how am I going to follow that? I said, are you kidding me? Come on.
Yeah. It's always tough when you're like following somebody that just smoked the house. You're like, shit, you know? Now, before I want to take a sidebar here, before we played that, Alexander was messing around on his bass playing Black Dog, correct?
Yeah.
All right. And he was kind of singing the words. Now, I pretty much know every single word to that song. Little story here. My girlfriend and I were driving, and I said, no, this is what he's saying. She goes, no, it's not. I said, honey, I'm telling you right now, this is what he said. She goes, no, absolutely not. So I want to see if you guys know the line, all right, where he goes, I don't know, but I've been told.
Big leg woman ain't got no soul.
Fucking A. There it is.
The whole song.
That's it. Yeah. She goes, he's not saying a big legged woman ain't got no soul. I said, honey, I'm telling you right now. She goes, why would he come up with that? A big legged, I forget what she thought he was singing, you know?
And that's what I want to know. What did she think he was singing?
Oh, man. You know what? Let's see if she's around right now. Let's just see. And we'll get her on the show. Let's just see.
Oh, she might be one of the harder ones. That was an
easy
line.
No, because I mean I knew that for years,
that's
you know.
Line, yeah. Yeah, totally.
I knew that for years and I was like, honey, I don't know what you're thinking, but let's just see if she answers the phone. She could be sleeping. This could go horribly wrong on the air.
You're here with some band you've never heard of.
Right. Live on the air.
Your call has been forwarded to an automated...
Come on, baby.
Radio bit.
Yeah, it's a classic radio bit. Your call has been forwarded.
That's what you get for not pre-recording them.
Come on, baby.
I'm here, baby.
Hey, you're on the air. We're recording. Don't say anything dirty. Well, you could say, why don't you say something dirty to me, baby?
Hey, baby, what do you want to hear?
Yeah. I'm in the studio here with Lost Romance, and I was just telling the story about how we were talking about Black Dog, and we had a bet that I was telling you the lyrics were, a big lay woman ain't got no soul.
He threw you right under the bus.
Oh my gosh, yep.
All right. Yeah, so I asked the band. I got the three of them here, and I asked the band. I said, let me see if you guys know it. And all three of them sang it at the same time. They said, well, what did your girlfriend think he was saying? I said, you know what? I can't remember. Let's call her and find out. So what did you think he was saying?
Oh, man, so embarrassing. Okay, please don't anybody laugh too hard.
Oh, it's too late for that, babe.
Okay, I thought it was feeble-headed woman ain't got no soul.
A feeble-headed woman ain't got no soul.
Oh, okay.
Which, I mean, kind of makes sense.
Now.
But we debated this all the way back from the store, and I said, listen, we're going to go on the internet, and I must have took her on 10 different sites that had the lyrics and showed her.
I crow big time that day. I was like, oh my God, I'm like the butcher of lyrics, and boy, was I wrong.
Yeah.
I feel like everyone has one song that's like that, though. That's
yeah, true. Right? That's well, true. I knew a girl, you know, Beast of Burden by the Stones.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
She actually thought they were saying pizza's burning.
Nice.
And I'm like, why the fuck would they write that? You know, I never thought your pizza's burning, you know?
At least my lyrics make sense.
Well, yes, it did make sense. All right, listen. Say hi to Lost Romance. First, say hi to Amin.
Hi.
Hello. How How are you?
Good.
All right, say hi to Jerry.
Jerry. Hey, hi, Jerry.
Hey, what's up?
And say hi to Alexander.
Alexander, how are ya?
Good, how are you?
All right.
Good, thanks.
All right, baby, let me get back to the show. I'm sure these guys are thrilled that they come in here for an interview and I call my chick.
Yeah, this is what they're waiting for, right?
Oh, well, yeah. You know how this show is. You know, you never know where the fuck it's going to go. Do you have anything just like a little sexy you could say for the show?
Wait, say again?
Do you have just a little something, you know, really sexy you can say for the show?
A little something, wow, okay. Right now, here?
No, next week. Yeah, right now, here.
Put her on the spot.
I know what you'd say if nobody else was here. All right, listen. I'm going to let you slide. I don't want people to think I'm whoring my chick on the show.
Think that.
Yeah, I know, right?
All right, baby doll.
All right, honey, love you.
All right, good night. Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Yeah, right.
Bye.
All right, so there you go. That's what she thought. A feeble-headed woman ain't got no soul. So when you played that, I said I got to do it. All right, I want to hear another song from you guys. What do you want to play?
Studio or acoustic?
Acoustic, man. Acoustic. You guys fucking right. Rock.
Let's think. We could do that. We can try it.
Sure.
Yeah, this is kind of a little heavier tune too. It's called Heart on a Wire. So acoustically, we're gonna see what we can do. See how we can bust it out.
It's usually more of a rocker. Is that the deal?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Hey.
fucking A, man. If that's the acoustic version, the electric version's got to fucking rock. That was fucking good, man. And I'm not just, you know, I'm not just blowing smoke, man, you know.
Thank you.
Well, I mean, not that kind of smoke. I mean,
that's a different kind.
That's a different kind of smoke. We'll be blowing later after the show, you know. But which, by the way, this is another conversation I had with my girlfriend, but we're not going to call her back on this one. Where does the expression and what exactly does it mean? Hey, man, I'm not blowing smoke up your ass. Why is that a good?
That's a good question. Like, I don't know.
I mean, when somebody goes, I'm not blowing smoke. Oh man, really? It's like, I don't want smoke blown up my ass.
Wait, you guys don't get that a lot? You don't actually have people blowing smoke up your ass often?
No, I do all the time, but I'm saying...
So I guess that's where it comes from, then.
The catchphrase.
Yeah, like the catchphrase, like...
people who don't...
Like, what does that technically mean? Where did it come from?
The origin of it, yeah.
Yeah, the origin. Like, why is blowing smoke up my ass a good thing? You know? Hey, man, I like you. I'm not just blowing smoke up your ass. And I'm like, well, I'd rather you just like me and not blow the smoke up my ass because, you know... I never did understand that.
Maybe they're not just doing it because they like you. Maybe they're doing it because there's something else behind it. There's another motive.
They really like to blow smoke up people's asses.
Maybe you got a great ass.
Well, I do have a great ass. The chicks tell me that, but, you know, I don't mean to sound cocky, but, you know, it's just something I was blessed with. But that fucking kicked ass, man. Nice. That really fucking kicked ass. And what was the name of that track again?
That song is called Heart on a Wire.
Heart on a Wire. You guys got to record that too, man.
That's coming next, man. It's coming next.
That's coming
all
next.
Coming down the line.
When do you think you'll be back in the studio recording more?
I definitely think before the end of the year. That's what we're looking for. So hopefully
good.
Get back in there before the end of the year. Probably do another EP. You know, it'd be like another five or six tunes, five or six songs. So,
now you have you have the Court Tavern gig lined up. Yep. Do you have some more gigs lined up?
We do actually. We got a couple shows this month. We're doing. We're playing actually an old school place called Dingbats over in
Clifton. Of course, it's been there forever.
Yeah, that place has been there forever. We're playing there this Saturday, August 10th. And it's going to be a great night. And then the next show after that is Philly. We're playing at the World Cafe Live on the 21st.
Great. Such a great place.
Yeah, it's going to be a cool night. And then 23rd, we're actually here in Manhattan at Tammany Hall down on the Lower East Side.
I saw that on your website.
Yep.
When is that date again?
August 23rd.
All right, Friday New night. York fucking city, because we got a lot of people in New York City. August 23rd, you got to go down and see these guys. Because I'm going to be there, so be there, and it's going to rock. It's definitely going to rock. You know what? I'm digging this so much, man. I want to hear another song.
Uh-oh. We're running out of tunes.
Nah, you ain't running out of tunes. You ain't running out of tunes. Come on.
All right, let's think what we can do.
Yeah, think what you can do. Take your time. No stress, no pressure.
Let's think going straight to the future. I was thinking more top of the world.
Top of the world, yeah. Okay, yeah. Well, we could do another...
Top of the World, which is on your EP.
It's on the EP, yep.
All right, you know what? I'd rather hear it this way, man, because you guys are rocking me, so...
Cool.
Let's do it.
Let's do it. Live on the edge, right?
Living on the edge.
I knew you were going to do that.
You guys like Aerosmith? Because if you don't like Aerosmith, this fucking interview is over.
It's over? I've been on the rock and roller coaster. Does that count?
Yeah, that'll work.
That's funny. Actually, we did a show, was it last year or the year before that? We did something at Bowery Electric with Joe Perry's sons have a band.
Sure.
Yeah.
Was it the Tab Band?
It was Tab the Band. Yep.
Tab the Band.
We did a show with those guys.
Sure.
And, yeah, good times.
It's actually two of his kids from two different moms. Mm-hmm. And now that they've actually added a couple of guys, so they changed the name of the band to Dead Boots.
Dead Boots, yeah, exactly.
Yeah, you're on top of that shit.
Good stuff. Yeah, we did a show with them. It was a lot of fun.
In fact, I saw when they first got together, Aerosmith was off the road, and Joe Perry decided to tour with them.
Right.
And do some gigs, and we went, and I was impressed.
Yeah, no, they're a great band.
You know, and they did some Aerosmith tunes, you know, that Joe sings on, and even songs that Steven sings on, and I was like, these guys are, like, good, you know? Definitely Tab the Band. In fact, I think they got a Dead Boots gig coming up here in the city pretty soon. But, Tab the Band, absolutely.
Yeah.
So, all right, let's do Top of the World, man.
All right. top of the world, with arms raised up to the sky, yelling to anyone to listen to what you have to say, to say.
You guys are tight, man. You guys are tight. And man, Jerry, your voice sounds incredible.
Thank you.
I'm amazed, really. I mean, and you guys are, I mean, we're sitting here in a studio playing acoustically. You know, I saw you live and you guys were great live. I can't wait to see you guys inside a club. You know, I can't wait to see that.
Thanks, man.
All right, let's promote all the gigs one more time, because I want to make sure that all our local listeners, you know, our local listeners got this going on. So this Saturday, is it this Saturday?
Yeah, August 10th. It's a Saturday at Dingbats in Clifton, New Jersey.
Okay.
For all the Jersey heads. And August 21st, we're playing at World Cafe live in Philly.
Are you playing with another band there? Are you guys?
It's actually a night. We're doing a night of songs by Elliot Smith. He's a songwriter from the 90s, you know, or like late 90s or so. And so it's a tribute to him. We're doing a couple songs of his, and it's going to be a bunch of other bands that night. And it's sponsored by a really cool blog called Tri-State Indie, in collaboration with the World Cafe. So it's going to be a lot of fun. And then the last show that we have this month is August 23rd at Tammany Hall in New York City.
And what night of the week is that?
That's a Friday night.
I think I'm going to make that show, man. I think I'm definitely going to make that show. And then we got the Cork Tavern gig on September
14th.
September 14th, which is the Saturday. That place is going to be packed for that.
We're anticipating it selling out for that particular show. We're going to have advance tickets available very soon. And actually, a good thing, once you get there, we're going to have wristbands so that you get an instant download of the record once you walk in the door. So,
wow. Yeah. Well, let me just put you on the spot and whore right now, man. I'd like to get on the guest list and be in that fucking show.
Well, you know, we'll see what we can do. Al's going to get you. He's got the hookups.
So all right. Al's got the hookups, you know. Well, my daughters hang out there a lot, too. Okay. So, you know. And my daughter's a beautiful girl, so maybe I should just go with my daughters instead of Alex, you
there
know.
You go.
But, but yeah, no, I just want to get in, you
right.
know what I mean?
You'll
I definitely
in.
Want
You'll
to
get
in.
Don't worry. Don't worry.
So, all right, very, very cool. Yeah. And then after that, is there anything else after the Court Tavern gig?
After the Court Tavern gig, I don't think we have anything major set right now, but looking at some other shows up and down, probably up in Boston we're going to do something again, probably in September, late September, early October, probably back up in Portland again. We'll do a Boston-Portland run. We usually do that in a weekend, so probably do that. Probably something in Connecticut again. And probably starting to do something a little more down south. We'll see where it goes.
And again, that's what I love about this band is that, you know, you're not just playing, you know, clubs in Jersey,
right.
you know, or even clubs in New York or even clubs, you know, the fact that, you're up and down, you know, the Northeast, I think is a very cool thing, you know, because you got to get out there, you know, and the way you're doing it is extremely smart, you know, hooking up with these other bands that have a following.
Mm-hmm.
For, you know, towns that you don't have a following. I mean, it's a beautiful thing. I love it, man.
Yeah, it's great. I mean, we've had pretty good success with it, and you know, it's a lot of fun. We and on top of that, we hook up with other radio stations in the area up there, and you know, different music blogs, and so it's like anytime you just step out of your comfort zone and go somewhere else, you know, good things happen. So
yeah, and that's the only way to do it, man.
Yeah.
So. I wish you guys the best of luck.
Thank you.
You know, continue to keep rocking because you guys are a great, great band. You're tight. There's a great feel. You know, for three guys in a room acoustically, I mean, this sounds fantastic. Once again, this has been Lost Romance on Rock Hard with Jay Conroy on Rock Hard Radio 1 from New York City. Don't want to put you guys on the spot, but I'm gonna because... You know, rather than play your studio stuff, you guys sound so great in the studio. Can we get another song out of you?
Another song, wow. Let's see what we can do. Let's see what we can do.
You guys will come up with something. I know you will. Because let me tell you, my listeners are going to love this, man.
The new one? Which one
was
that?
No, not the new one. I need the real drum set.
No.
If you can't come up with something,
you?
If you can't,
yeah.
if you can't come up with something,
okay,
we could do
okay.
Black Dog.
No. There we go. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
There you go.
All right. What are we gonna do?
This is a fairly new song. This is a pretty brand new song. It's called "I Want You."
All right. Let's do it.
One, two, three, four. I don't care, I don't mind, I guess I know.
Great. Lost Romance, everybody. I want to thank you guys so much for coming in to do the show. Once again, Amin Smyers. Did I say that right, Amin?
Yep.
All right. Jerry Perlinski, Alexander Paul from Lost Romance. I'm going to give it up myself for you guys. All right. Thank you very much for coming in and doing the show. I'd like to have you guys back.
Absolutely.
You know, when you do some more stuff or whatever it is, you're always welcome back. Thank you very much for coming in and doing the show. You guys were phenomenal, and I can't thank you enough, man.
Thank you, Jerry.
All right.
Appreciate it.
I'll see you guys. I'll probably see you guys at the gig in New York, and also the Court Tavern, because right. Both of those places are easy for me to get to. Mm-hmm. All right, we'll be right back with a little more from Rock Hard with Jay Conroy on Rock Hard Radio 1. Stand by. All right, I hope you enjoyed that, the interview with Lost Romance. Very cool guys. And again, go check out their website. Lost Romance, check them out on Facebook, check them out live. They got a lot of gigs coming up all over, you know, like we were talking about, from Connecticut down to Philly, so check them out. All right, we got to say goodnight. I want to thank you so very, very much from the bottom of my heart. I am so grateful that you listen to this show. I've said it before, I'll say it again, without you, there's no show. Well, there's a show, but I'd be the only one listening to it, all right? So thank you very much. I will see you next week. Until then, rock hard.